Grace and peace to you. Welcome in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ on this Sunday morning. We're glad to see you here and just pray that God will move in you and through you today as we share our worship together. There are a number of announcements in your bulletin. You can look at those at your leisure. There's a couple things that we'd like to bring up. Wednesday night, the 6:30 p.m. Daniel Plan Bible study with fellowship and food. I encourage you to try to attend. On Friday, October 17th from noon to 1, and hopefully each Friday to follow, they're going to attempt to have the weekly luncheons that you used to have here in the church basement. So, and it'll be a joint venture with the United Methodist Church. Bring your own lunch, enjoy the fellowship, and share your faith. Assistant technologist position is still vacant. This is important. If any of you can make it up the stairs, it's not very hard to work the camera. Bob needs it. If there's ever a time when he is unavailable, then we're going to need somebody up there to turn off and on certain switches for mics and that sort of thing, and I'm sure he'd be more than happy to train you. It would certainly give him peace of mind. We have birthdays today. Lori Salazar is today, October 12th. And then we have Sam on October 15th, and Kent Sheila Delzell's anniversary is today. So we want to make sure we wish congratulations to all of those folks. Are there any other announcements that we want to make? Yes.
Well, Christine Boyd called this morning, and her brother John is in the hospital, and would like for him to be on the prayer list. He's from the Wellman area.
So Christine Boyd's brother John is in the hospital.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Betty Jean Marks, my sister-in-law down in Missouri, they found three spots on the brain, and she's going to do an extensive chemotherapy again.
So Betty Jean Marks, they found three spots on her brain, and they're going to be doing chemo, not radiation.
I'll give you an update on Chrissy Hamilton. From what I've heard, she was supposed to be home this weekend for that open house, but she got worse. They had surgery Wednesday or Thursday. Somehow there's a cement ball in her hip, and it's to keep her bones or something from collapsing. I guess it's, and then she got to go to the care center for rehab and. You know, just doesn't look very good. But I want to thank the church and Sunday school for the money that I got sent. So Carla was here, I think Thursday night or something, at Elvis, and was on her way down. But the look good. So Chrissy Hamilton had surgery Thursday. Wednesday or Thursday, yes. I'm not really quite sure what day it was.
And thanks to the church for its generosity. Is there any other yes?
Colleen Mensker is home and doing pretty good. She's got the Debbie's recovery, so she's doing really good. We saw her yesterday, and things are good. She had a knee replaced.
She's at home, not in rehab?
She's, yeah, at her daughter's daddy's. In the army. So give me care there.
Yes.
I want to say Eloise and I have got a
car in between our home, and it's about this big, and it put the leaf on it. I just kind of caught a glimpse of something. Now, what is that? But it is beautiful. It is amazing what these ugly little mean things can do. And it's getting to the point where, I guess we looked it up on the internet, and it's paper thin. And once the really cold freeze or frost or something, then they die. So it'll be that you can go and snip it off. Because I thought maybe the school kids might take a day when it's nice out to look at it. Because it is, it's beautiful. But it was kind of scary to look at it. Like, see this big drop. And I'm like, what in heaven's name? And it's got two little branches. And the branches are so small. But it's through this hornet's nest. It's crazy. But we got new neighbors. For a while, anyway. Yeah.
You think of them much more charitably than I do. Right, are there any other announcements that need to be made? And seeing none, let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we listen to the prelude.
Good morning, everyone. Please stand if you're able and join me in the call to worship as we prepare our hearts for worship. Some seek signs and others seek wisdom.
But we proclaim Christ crucified.
A stumbling block to some and foolishness to others.
To all who are called, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God.
Worship the risen Lord, our God. Praise him. Please remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, page number 1, Holy, Holy, Holy. Seated. Join me now in the responsive reading number 106 in the Living Bible located at the back of your pews. Number 106. Don't just pretend that you love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Stand on the side of good.
Love each other with brotherly affection and take delight in honoring each other.
Never be lazy in your work, but serve the Lord enthusiastically.
When God's children are in need, you be the one to help them out. And get into the habit of inviting guests home for dinner, or if they need lodging for the night.
Never pay back evil for evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you are honest, clear through.
Don't quarrel with anyone. Be at peace with everyone. Just as much as possible.
Dear friends, never avenge yourselves. Leave that to God, for he has said that he will repay those who deserve it. Don't take the law into your own hands.
Instead, feed your enemy if he is hungry. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink, and you will be heaping coals of fire on his head. In other words, he will feel ashamed of himself for what he has done to you.
Don't let evil get the upper hand, but conquer evil by doing good.
Pay all your debts, except the debt of love for others. Never finish paying that, for if you love them, you will be obeying all of God's laws, fulfilling all his requirements.
If you love your neighbor as much as you love yourself, you will not want to harm or cheat him, or kill him, or steal from him. And you won't sin with his wife, or want what is his, or do anything else the Ten Commandments say is wrong.
All ten are wrapped up in this one, to love your neighbor as you love yourself.
Love does no wrong to anyone. That's why it fully satisfies all of God's requirements. It is the only law you need.
Another reason for right living is this. You know how late it is. Time is running out. Wake up, for the coming of the Lord is nearer now than when we first believed.
The night is far gone. The day of his return will soon be here. So quit the evil deeds of darkness and put on the armor of right living, as we who live in the daylight should.
Be decent and true in everything you do, so that all can approve your behavior.
The proof of God's amazing love is this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God with confidence. In faith and penitence, let us confess our sin before God and one another as we first confess our sins together using the unison prayer printed in your bulletin, and then by coming silently before the throne of God as individuals. Let us pray. We are conscious, O Lord, of our unworthiness to be in your presence. We hear you saying to us, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Yet we have wandered after our own will and sought our own pleasures and turned aside from the cross. Forgive us our sins, we beseech you, and with your forgiveness, grant us both the will and the power to repent and amend. Help us this day to do your will on earth as it is done in heaven. May we see in each person we meet that better person that it is your will he become. May we do unto others what we would want them to do to us and for us, not just neighbors and friends, but to strangers and enemies, even as you loved us and sacrificed yourself for us when we were enemies of you. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. May the God of mercy, who forgives you all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the
You may be seated. Please join me now in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. O Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, and strength to follow on the path you set before us. Through Jesus Christ, amen. Our first scripture reading today is found in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through 16, page number 1887 in your pew Bibles. These scripture verses talk about how we sometimes feel pulled back to our old ways of living after committing our lives to Christ. Peter tells us to be like our Heavenly Father, holy in everything we do. Holiness means being totally devoted or dedicated to God, set aside for his special use, and set apart from sin and its influence. God gives us his Holy Spirit to help us obey him and power to overcome sin. 1 Peter 1, 13 through 16. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, "Be holy because I am holy." Our second scripture today is found in Genesis 6, verses 1 through 12, page number 9 of your pew Bibles. These scriptures speak about God's great patience with mankind. He gives us time to quit living our way and begin living his way, the way he shows us in his word. The sins of his people grieve the Lord. However, we can please him with our obedience to his word and influencing others to do the same. Genesis 6, 1 through 12. When men began to increase in number on the earth and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. Then the Lord said, "My spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God went to the daughters of men and had children by them. They were the heroes of old, men of renown. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. The Lord was grieved that he had made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. So the Lord said, I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals, and creatures that move along the ground, and birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked with God. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. Our third and final scripture reading today comes from Isaiah 6, verses 1 through 8. Page number 1068 of your pew Bibles. These verses speak about God's holiness and forgiveness. Holiness means morally perfect, pure, and set apart from all sin. We need the Bible's view of God as high and lifted up to empower us to deal with our problems and concerns. When we realize our sins in God's eyes, we then can realize his forgiveness. Isaiah 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, Here I am, send me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We are drawing closer to the end of the series here on the attributes of God. And I know I've said this a lot throughout the scripture or through the sermons and stuff, but it seems like every time I come up to an attribute of God, I say, now this is one of the hardest ones to explain. And yet, maybe that just goes to show us the difference between God and ourselves, because guess what? Working with the holiness and justice of God, and they do go together and are intertwined, is one of the hardest attributes of God to explain. It's easy to say a definition. It's tough to understand it and comprehend it in its fullness and experience. I want to read to you what some scholars and Bible teachers have said about this topic. Elmer Towns, in his book Studies in Theology, has said, Holiness may be one of the most difficult of the attributes to completely understand and define. Tozer writes, We cannot grasp the true meaning of divine holiness. It stands apart, unique, unapproachable, incomprehensible, and unattainable. The nature of man is blind to it. He may fear God's power and admire his wisdom, but his holiness he could never even imagine. So people have been trying to define holiness, despite that, the fact that it seems to be undefinable. Tony Evans, who's a great speaker I've heard at Promise Keepers, in his book, Our God is Awesome, attempts to define the holiness of God, and he writes, "The holiness of God is his intrinsic and transcendent purity, the standard of righteousness to which the whole universe must conform." He goes on to say that God does not conform to any standard created by others. He is the standard. Therefore, he demands that his creation conform to his standards. And the professor Thiessen said in his introductory lectures, said, "The holiness of God means that he is absolutely separate from and exalted above all his creation, and that he is equally separate from moral evil and sin." So even though we cannot completely understand God's holiness, we still need to understand something about it, because it impacts our life today. We, as was noted in Peter, are called to be holy. Now, if we don't understand anything about what it means to be holy, how can we possibly do it? And why would God call us to be holy? Those are two things that I hope we're going to work with today. Before I get to that, and that is going to be the primary focus, I want to mention a little bit about God's justice as well. Justice was another one of those things that I had problems getting defined. There's lots of definitions out there that are in dictionaries, Merriam-Webster's dictionary, etc. But if you look at the definitions, they're all circular. Justice is the act of being just. Okay, what does it mean to be just? Well, being just means doing justice. So what does that mean? Some people try to talk about equity or fairness, which I don't happen to agree with. One of the points I want to make is justice is not the same as fairness. Justice is not the same as fairness. Finally, in one of the dictionary.com, I think it was, I found a series of definitions of justice as a noun. And it says that quality of being just, righteousness, equitableness, or moral rightness, to uphold the justice of a cause. Notice that even there, it keeps defining itself in terms of itself. But it has some extra stuff there with righteousness, equitableness, and moral rightness. A second definition in there says rightfulness or lawfulness, as of a claim or title. And then it says justness of ground or reason to complain with justice. A third definition says the moral principle determining just conduct. Well, there justice is being defined in terms of being just again. Administering of deserved punishment or reward was a fifth one. A fourth one was conformity to this principle as manifested in conduct, just conduct, dealing, or treatment. So justice is really hard to define. Let me give you my take on it. And you can put this down as the John Evans definition of justice. Justice is getting what we deserve. Justice is getting what we deserve. Even as grace is getting what we don't deserve. Justice is getting what we deserve. And there's a lot of people out there that would say, well, shoot fire, then I deserve a lot of good stuff. And I certainly don't deserve to be in the situation I'm in. The problem with that is we have a very limited view. We wear our own blinders when we think about ourselves. Man has the almost infinite capacity to lie to himself. Let's face it. If we were to truly be able, as God is omniscient, remember, we went through that one a couple months ago. He knows everything. everything we've ever done, everything we ever are going to do, everything we've ever thought. And Jesus makes clear that the intent can be as damaging as the actual act when it comes to our souls. He who is angry at another has committed murder in his heart. He who lusts after another has committed adultery. Now, you start defining it that way, and you take off even the blinders a little bit. And I don't know about you, but there's a lot of stuff that's out there that I probably should be ashamed of and am ashamed of. And I know that we like to try and keep a tally score in our heads, some of us, and we sit there and say, yeah, but the good that I did here more than outweighs the bad. The problem is we're held up to a standard of God. Everyone will be, because originally we had the capability of living sinless lives. Adam and Eve chose to sin out of their free will and fell from that state. And we follow along with original sin. And we don't live holy lives. God is absolutely holy. Now, the basic definition of holiness is, as was noted by Mary, different or separate. And God is wholly different. And he is wholly separate, not from us as believers, but from sin. He can't stand it. He hates sin. And his justice, which is intertwined with that, would say then we're all doomed. And yet his love, which we're going to talk about in a coming week, was so great that he sent his son to die for us, to cleanse us of that sin, so that when he looks at us, he sees Jesus, who did live a sinless life, who showed us that we can do it. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we can present ourselves before God, not getting justice in terms of what we deserve, but justice in terms of what God sees in us in Christ. And that, my friends, is mercy. That's grace that has been extended to us. So God is holy, and he calls us to be holy so that we can, if you will, escape his justice. And Peter, in his letter here, talks about that. To be self-controlled, set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. Do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. You see, we should know better now. We have Christ within us. Just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do, for it is written, be holy because I am holy. So we are called to have that holiness. We're called to have that differentness. We're called to have that separateness from sin, not from the world, although we are in some ways separate from the world. So what does that mean to be holy? Somebody whose name I forgot to get had a wonderful idea for an acronym. If you think of holy as an acronym, he said the letter H would be humbleness. We must be humble. Micah 6:8 talks about, what does the Lord require of you? To do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. We talked a little bit just last week about the, or 2 weeks ago, about the humility of Christ. It seems like some people go through their entire life and just never get the need for humility. A newspaper reporter was interviewing an old rancher and asked him what he would attribute his success as a rancher. With a twinkle in his eye, the man replied, "It's been about 50% weather, 50% good luck, and the rest is just pure brains." Sometimes people get a dose of humility whether or not they ask for it. There's a story that says that Muhammad Ali, and you guys will know who he is, not my son, was in his prime. As he was about to take off of an airplane on an airplane flight, the stewardess reminded him to fasten a seatbelt. He came back brashly, "Superman don't need no seatbelt." The stewardess quickly came back, "Superman don't need no airplane either." Ali, now humbled, fastened his belt. So one way or another, you will be humbled, whether you seek it out yourself or honor God through it, and honor God through it, or sooner or later, you'll find that opportunity. And we should. We talked a couple weeks ago about having Christ's humility and serving one another and placing others above ourselves. We need to be humble as part of being holy. Certainly, it's not the way the world works here today. The O in holy means obedience. A few centuries before Christ, a man named Alexander conquered almost all the known world using military strength, cleverness, and a little bit of diplomacy. The story is told that Alexander and a small company of soldiers approached a strongly fortified walled city. Alexander, standing outside the walls, raised his voice and demanded to see the king. When the king arrived, Alexander insisted that the king surrender the city and its inhabitants to Alexander and his little band of fighting men. The king laughed, "Why should I surrender to you? You can't do us any harm." But Alexander offered to give the king a demonstration. He ordered his men to line up in single file and start marching. He marched them straight toward a sheer cliff. The townspeople gathered on the wall and watched in shocked silence as one by one Alexander's soldiers marched without hesitation right off the cliff to their deaths. After 10 soldiers died, Alexander ordered the rest of the men to return to his side. The townspeople and king immediately surrendered to Alexander the Great. They realized that if a few men were actually willing to commit suicide at the command of this dynamic leader, then nothing could stop his eventual victory. The Bible tells another story about obedience. For a lot of the disciples' time they spent with Jesus, they just don't seem to get it. After feeding the 5,000, the disciples were faced with a similar predicament. How were they going to feed another large crowd of people, this time 4,000? And they totally missed the opportunity as they forgot how Jesus had just turned some bread and a few fish into a feast. Other times, we look at in the Bible, we see examples of real obedience as people do things that may not seem to be or make sense. Abraham following God's plan all the way from Ur to the land that became Israel, to the land of the Canaanites. Jesus himself, who in the Garden of Gethsemane said, "If it's possible, take this cup from me, nevertheless, thy will be done." And he was obedient even unto death. Through the Holy Spirit, we can obey God. We trust in him. And if we trust, like that old hymn says, we will trust, we will obey. Trust and obey. The L in holy means loving. As we're taught to love one another and put their needs first, even as was in our responsive reading today. Love, like nothing else, changes us into the holy people God wants us to be. When questioned about what the most important commandment was, Jesus said, "We must love God above everything else and love each other." That's it, we're to love. Everything else follows under the heading of love. If we love like Christ, every other Christ-like character will fall into place. How can we be holy people if we don't represent God with love? So we need to be humble, we need to be obedient, we need to be loving, and we need to be yielded. I recently read how Americans are on guard all the time. When the phone rings, we wonder who's calling to try and sell us something we don't need. I am so guilty of that. We have cell phones, but we intentionally give out our landline only so that when those telemarketers call, we can just ignore them. When the doctor's office calls to remind us of an appointment or something, we can just listen to the message later. We keep the handset in a different room where we are, and the first thing we do when we call is we look and see what it says. We're guarded. When the doorbell rings, we wonder who is at our door trying to disrupt our peaceful family time, or what religion are they representing? When we're spoken to out in public, we begin to think on the motives of the person speaking to us. And try to keep them out of our personal space. And by the way, Americans have some of the largest personal space in the world. Anybody who's traveled abroad knows, you know, all these other cultures, they come up close, they kiss on either cheek, or they hug, they shake it. We're the ones that came up with shaking hands. What does that do? Nobody gets closer to you than about 4 feet. We have this intense idea of personal space. We have such high walls around us, built up around us, that it is virtually impossible for anyone to get inside. I heard once that we have such high walls up trying to protect us that Satan doesn't even have to work very hard at keeping God out, as we do it fairly well ourselves. We have to ask ourselves, as we try to follow what God calls us to do, if we desire to become holy people, are we surrendering everything over to Him? Are we yielded over His plan in our lives? Or are we still trying to, as Frank Sinatra sang once, do it my way? To do it our way. Just how much of us does the Holy Spirit have? 10%? 40%? 75%? Or maybe more like 99%? We want to give over everything to Him, but there's just one or two things we're keeping back. A committee of ministers in a certain city was discussing the possibility in the 1920s of having D.L. Moody to serve as evangelist during a citywide evangelistic campaign. Finally, one young minister who did not want to invite Moody stood up and said, "Why, Moody? Does he have a monopoly of the Holy Spirit?" There was silence, and then an old godly minister spoke up. "No, he doesn't have a monopoly of the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit has a monopoly of D.L. Moody." Ask yourself, does the Holy Spirit have a monopoly on your life? Are we representing Jesus Christ in a holiness capacity? Are we humble? Are we obedient? Are we loving? And are we yielded? Are we holy as God is holy? Do we keep ourselves from sin? Do we follow the leading of the Holy Spirit? This is our challenge today. Because one of the things that I want to close with is that we don't need to fear the consequences of following Christ. No matter what the world may do to us, we have the assurance of an eternal future and a victory with God. A victory that was sealed with a price on the cross. But then it didn't end there. It wasn't just that our sins were cleansed so that we could be holy. Jesus Christ was raised from the dead after 3 days so that we could have a new life, be new creatures in Him. Being holy should be a joyful task, not a fearful one. As we take communion here in a couple minutes, I would ask you to think on what Christ did for you, not so that you feel guilty. I always like to stress that this is a celebration, but so that you can remember the wonderful thing that God did for you, and then think about the call God places in your life today to be holy even as He is holy, and to use the transfusion of the Spirit if you will, that we get through communion to help strengthen you in doing what is right and what is good. And if you do that, then justice will follow, even as it will with God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Our next hymn is number 472, Take Time to Be Holy. If you'd stand if you're able. Let's do verses 1 through 3.
Take time to be holy, speak oft with thy Lord, abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends with God's children, help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to seek. Take time to be holy, the world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy, let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide. In joy or in sorrow, still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word.
Please be seated. Take out your communion liturgy. Note that in the Presbyterian Church, we practice what is known as open communion. You don't need to be a member of this church. You don't even need to be Presbyterian. You just need to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And you're welcome to come to the table. Also, despite what it says in the liturgy, which I wrote, we do practice intinction here, which means that rather than us bringing out the bread and the cup to you, you come forward to take the bread and cup at one time. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we may truly love you and worthily praise your holy name, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Come to the Lord's table, all you who love him. Come to the Lord's table, confess your sin. Come to the Lord's table and be at peace. For the Lord is here.
God's Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right always and everywhere to give thanks to you, the true and living God, through Jesus Christ. You are the source of life for all creation, and you made us in your own image. In your love for us, you sent your Son to be our Savior. He suffered death on the cross for us. You raised him in triumph and exalted him to glory. Through him, you send your Holy Spirit upon us and make us your people. We proclaim your glory as together with all the saints of every time and place and all the angels as we sing,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
You are holy, Almighty One. Blessed are you, Jesus Christ. In the power of the Spirit you created all things. Bless them and call them good. You called to yourself a people. By your incarnation, life, suffering, execution, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery, and made a new covenant with us by water and the Spirit. Experiencing God's love and sure of his place as his children, let us together say the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples using debts and debtors. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and he blessed it. And he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this, remembering me." In a like manner, after the supper, he took the cup. And he poured it, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the remission of sins. Whenever you drink of this, do this remembering me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the saving death of your risen Lord until he comes." Come to the table. Thank you. Together, let us say the prayer after communion. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you with all our hearts for your mercy and grace. Give us now and in the days to come a living hope in you. And as we serve you in the world, help us look and work for that day when at your name every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We now take our offering, dedicating the money for the work of the church. And Lord, we ask that you use all that we have and are in your service. May you meditate on God's blessings in your life and give back joyfully, cheerfully, and generously unto the work of his church here in Morning Sun. Say the prayer dedication, which is printed in your bulletin with me. Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Now is the time in our worship service when we get to have the prayers for the people. We are a people who believe, a church who believes in the power of prayer and in the ability of each person to come before God, needing no other intermediary than Jesus Christ. I commend the list of joys and concerns which is in your bulletin to you to pray for each and every day. Let us come before God in prayer. God, our creator, maker of the universe, you are such an awesome God. You are the Almighty One, and we give you praise and glory. Lord, you are the creator, and not a breath we take occurs without your willing it. We give you thanks for your love for us, that we don't get what we deserve, but instead, each and every day, each and every moment, we receive grace and mercy from you. Lord, we could not have earned our way back into heaven and into your good graces, because we can't be perfect as you are. We can't be holy as you are. But we give you thanks that Jesus Christ came and lived among us and suffered and died for us to wash us clean of the stain of that sin and was resurrected that we might have new life and have it abundantly so that we can come before you wearing his righteousness and receiving your grace. And Lord, we thank you that you have healed within us your image as the Holy Spirit resides with us. We thank you, O Lord, that you have made us whole. And we ask prayers now for those who are sick and are hurt. Whether it be spiritual, physical, or mental, lay your healing hand upon them. Make them whole to serve your purposes and do your will. We ask special prayers for Pauline Metzger as she recovers from the knee replacement at her daughter's. Speed it along, Lord, and make it complete. We ask prayers for Christine Boyd, who is in the brother is in the hospital. We ask prayers for John. Guide the hands and eyes of the doctors that they might be able to diagnose and treat whatever it might be. We give prayers for Chrissy Hamilton and the surgery she had. May the recovery from that be swift. Lord, she has so much else that's going on with her right now. Make that one little bit at least a moment of comfort. Lord, we give you thanks that so many people in this church are generous in their support of someone who is in need as they show a true heart of love for those around them. And Lord, we give a special prayer for Betty Jean Marks, who has 3 spots on her brain and has begun the chemo. Lord, just be with her and strengthen her. May it be a time with all of these people in their trials when they turn to you and not from you. Lord, where they lean on you, and may we be Christ to them, wrapping them in your loving arms and lifting them up to your face. And Holy Spirit, be with each one of us. Help us to see what your will is, to understand what is holy, to understand what you call us to do, to help us to never forget the grace which we have already received in Jesus Christ, so that we might have the courage of heart to step out and do what you call us to do, to live lives that are holy and are different and are separate, so that people look at us and they see you. And Holy Spirit, give us the perseverance of spirit to complete the tasks you have for us as trials come in our lives and storms come. Be our rock and our anchor so that we're not overwhelmed. And one day then we can hear those wonderful words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Holy Spirit, be poured out upon this church. Lord, may it be a light in the darkness. Keep it from evil. Expand its boundaries and its ministries so that it might be a better testimony to you, leading others to your love and your grace and your mercy, so they too can know the joy of forgiveness and the promise of eternity. For we ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Our final hymn today is number 239, "For the Beauty of the Earth." I'd like for us to sing verses 1, 3, and 4. 1, 3, and 4. If you'd stand if you're able. Now may you go forth from this place, recharged and renewed, ready to serve the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, loving your neighbor as yourselves, and living lives that are holy and dedicated to him. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.